All right. Hello, everybody. Thank you for being here. I am super excited. Another NDE journey with Megan Brown. I am very excited to have you, Megan, here with me. Thank you for giving me your time.
Oh, well, thank you for having me on your platform. I really appreciate it, getting the word of love out. So it's wonderful.
It is wonderful, and I'm noticing the more I do these, the more like the word love comes up a lot, which is beautiful because for us to get to that fifth dimension, for us to ascend, the word love is probably the most important thing that we have to talk about. So I guess it's not a surprise that these type of interviews are coming into my channel now. And me becoming part of the Near Death Institute board, there's a connection there. So I'm very excited. So, as I tell everybody that I talk to, Megan, tell us your story. Tell us your story. What happened? Who you were before it happened, what happened, and how your life changed with this amazing experience.
Okay, so I'll start off by letting you know, you and the listeners know that I grew up on a farm. I was raised Roman Catholic in California, and it was regular life, although it wasn't regular because there were so many things that happened to me growing up. I had two near-death experiences, one as a child, and then the other as a teenager. And then when I was 20, I was raped. And then from that, I decided that there was no God. How could there be a God if that was going to happen to me? So I just decided to check out. And I thought, okay, yeah, whatever. Save your God stuff. I'm not going back to church. Not happening. So I just went along my life. I worked and then. Keeping myself busy, horseback riding, playing tennis, doing things like that. And then I got married when I was in my 30s, and I was a stay-at-home mom, and it was great. When this happened, the last near-death experience, I had been working out that day because I worked out constantly, and I remember going to bed that night, and my stomach was really upset. Well, it got worse and worse where I had to drive myself to the hospital in the middle of the night. And then it took a full day and a half actually, to get me to the final hospital where I wound up, because they had an endocrinologist there. And I was diagnosed with C. diff colitis, a very severe case of it. And I was in a lot of pain. But as I was experiencing that and being treated for that, the pain started to move around, like my back, my lower back, in my abdomen area. I was in so much pain. And then my legs, I couldn't move my legs, couldn't move my feet. I couldn't move my hips. I felt my whole body was becoming paralyzed. And I kept ringing the nurse's station. Later, I found out that they were being told not to come in and assist me because the doctor wound up coming in. He finally came in, I think his second time, and he looked at me and says, I've treated you for the C. diff colitis. I've given you 2 milligrams of morphine. I've upped it to 4 milligrams of morphine. I think you're a drug seeker. And to which I was so upset. And I looked at him. I was like in shock. And I heard, make a scene, make it big, or you won't make it out. So I thought, well, I'm in a Catholic hospital. I know exactly what to say. So I did. And I was very offensive. And I rattled the bed rails. And then I fired him. And he didn't believe it. And he stood there. And I thought, wow, okay, well, my scene wasn't big enough. So I said more. And then, if I could have gotten out of the bed to slap him, I would have, because this guy, it was like, what are you not getting from me? I am like, I'm in so much pain. This is unbelievable. So finally, he leaves, and this nurse comes in, and she says, "I'm sorry, ma'am, we don't have another doctor for you." And I said, "Really? You're going to find me one? I'm in an effing hospital, blah, 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 blah." And she found one. And this hospitalist comes in, another woman, and immediately she knew something was wrong. Because what the doctor didn't tell me was that I'd gained 43 pounds of fluid in 3 days, and I had turned gray. So she said to the nurse next to her, "Has anybody checked her creatinine level?" And the answer was no. So I was in full-blown kidney failure. My kidneys had stopped. So finally, when I was diagnosed accurately, I was taken to dialysis, and then that's where it all began. I finally started getting proper treatment, but it only took 4 days to get there. So I was in a lot of pain and a lot of frustration and trying to save my own life, because at that time I was an atheist. So I was really afraid of dying, because I thought, oh my gosh, who's going to be here for my son? I mean, his dad's away for work all the time. Who's going to be his mom? I have to stay here. So that was like my drive to stay for my son, not die.
Yes.
Because I really thought that there was death at that moment.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah. But that's not the case.
Yeah.
Not the case.
Yeah. So then she, what happened with her? What did she say after she mentioned what she wanted, what she was thinking it was?
Well, they didn't understand why I was in kidney failure. They knew that they had to like figure it out. Like, how is this woman so rapidly? How did this turn into kidney failure? So I was also told that for like 2 nights straight, the nursing staff would stay up overnight. Now, I was in the Midwest when this happened. I'm originally from Southern California. So I really believe now that heaven moved me and my family to the Midwest for this purpose, so that I could experience this and come back and talk about love, because I wouldn't have gotten the same care in Los Angeles because they're so overcrowded and so overpacked. Wow. So, yeah, so it, you know, it is what it is, but finally somebody in dialysis later told me that the nurses were staying up for 2 nights in a row to try and figure out and look at the numbers and like, why were some of my, was my blood work so off? What could that be affiliated with? So what they finally diagnosed me with was TTP-HUS, which is thrombotic thrombocytopenia purpura hemolytic uremic syndrome.
Oh my gosh.
And yeah. So it's a blood disease.
Okay.
And there are four different ways that it can come about, but I didn't qualify for any of those ways. And, you know, it's so wild because I just read something the other day, like literally last week. I didn't even know this, but the blood is the life force, is considered the life force in the body. And of course I'm botching what I read, but that was so profound for me the other day. I went, all of these years, I didn't know that the blood is considered the life force. You know, if somebody said, what's the life force in your body? I would have guessed the heart, you know, but it wasn't, it's the blood of life. Wow. So I thought that was pretty interesting. Yeah. But once I got to dialysis and they, after they'd properly diagnosed me, they started the dialysis treatments. And then I don't remember how much longer after that started, where I wound up walking through clouds. And I remember seeing Jesus standing under trees over to my left. And then all, you know, it was like this grassy park. There was a blue sky with clouds in it, birds flying. It looked like Earth. And it was beautiful. And I remember I looked at him and I said, oh my God, you really do exist. And to which he laughed. And then he opened up his arms and he's like indicating, come over, give me a hug. And I did. And as soon as I gave him the hug, he turned me to walk with him. And he said, come on, we have a lot of work to do. And I said, yeah, I know, you're dealing with me.
Yeah.
So he was like, okay, there was no judgment, by the way, there was no judgment. So he took me over to meet my other guides. And then we went in and watched my life review. So.
Okay. So there was no like tunnel. It was almost like just appeared there, like just appeared there or in that space that we're going to call heaven for now, because we can reference it that way. But when you saw it, that were the colors brighter, like almost like not neon, but like you could see more colors or more, you know, those TVs that have like a 4K TVs where it's really crisp, like what you see, it's really crisp and detailed. Did it change like that at all for you? Like, was it more, how would you compare it to Earth?
Okay. Well, that's a good question. It was definitely more vivid, but I believe it's because everything, all of your senses come alive there. I mean, your soul knows exactly where you are. Your soul knows exactly what to do, but I wasn't there to stay. So I didn't remember everything getting in there.
Right. Well, seeing Jesus, I'm sure it's like your attention now is on him, not on like, oh, wow, this is beautiful kind of thing.
Yeah, my attention was on him, but I just wanted to get back to my son. I thought, okay, what do I have to do? I didn't even think at first. I was like, okay, well, Jesus is here, so this has got to be heaven. Because like, where else could it have been? You know?
Yeah. So was it just a garden
I think
that you saw? Was there anything else other than the garden? You there?
Sorry. Yeah, my computer, I tried seeing this last night, and for some reason, it just, I'll drop off or it'll freeze. And I don't understand why, so I apologize.
It could be the internet.
Could be, yeah. So I just wanted to get back. I just wanted to get back to my son. So I wasn't really feeling what it was, this place that I was in at first. I've never put my feelings to it in other interviews that I've done. So I'm trying to do that right now. And I do remember that I just had to do whatever I had to do to get back to my son. That was my driving force. So, but yes, the colors were clear there.
Okay. And was it just a garden? Was there anything else other than just grass and flowers and trees?
Oh no, there is a whole life there. There is a whole life happening there. I mean, after my life review, then I went with Archangel Michael, and then I met with him in his golden capsule. I mean, that's where the life review happened, in a golden capsule. And then I went from that capsule to another golden capsule, because Archangel Michael is my other guide. So it was Jesus, Archangel Michael, Mother Mary, El Moria, and Saint Germain. And then after meeting with Archangel Michael, then we went, he said, come on, there are others who want to meet with you. God wants to meet with you. And I was like, what? You know, this was shocking. So I'm thinking, there's a God? Okay. Others want to meet with me? I couldn't understand why. I'm like, oh my God, I'm going to be here a while, you know?
Yeah.
And
So before you come on.
Yeah.
Exciting. Okay. So this pod that Archangel Michael put you in when you saw your life review, I hear that when you're seeing things that you've done unto others that hurt them, that you don't necessarily feel it, that it's more like just like almost like a movie where you're like, oh, okay, right? Like, how was that life review for you?
Oh, well, no, you do feel it. And yes, it is like a movie. You do watch it. And what made it so difficult for me, because I'd come from a you know, a really rough upbringing. It was so traumatic in so many moments that I had to feel it over again. Mm. But not only that, I had to hear what was going on in the other person's head. Oh yeah. If there's anything that you do to somebody, or if there's judgment, or if there's something that you've done that's malicious, oh, you're going to hear it again.
Okay.
You're going to hear it again, and you're going to feel it. And so what I found to be interesting was that my guides, when they could see that I was crying, because it was so overwhelming, like for instance, my car accident when I was a kid, my best friend and her mother both passed away. And so here I am going, oh, they died, right? So, because I was Catholic then, I'm thinking, okay, well, they died. What is heaven? I didn't know. I didn't believe. I mean, it was like, what do angels do? Just stand around and like, woo, flutter their wings? I mean, I had no clue. And it was absolutely feeling everything and really recognizing where you were at in that moment. And when my guides would stop me, they would say, okay, now how do you feel about this situation, having seen it again? And so it was like, I call it heaven therapy, because they're basically helping me through the moment, as they're going to help everybody through whatever moments that they've been through.
Okay. Okay. So I imagine that alone will change who you are when you come back, because now you're have this awareness of like, when you say something like, right, and there's judgment, or you catch yourself judging, or like, I'm sure there's more going on here, right? Like,
yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And it definitely changed me when I came back, because I had a lot of judgment before that near death experience. I did have judgment. I had mainly judgment of myself, but there were moments that I judged other people. Oh, absolutely. Yep. And I'm very conscious about what I'm thinking. And if I feel something about a person, this just happened the other day with me. And there was somebody that just, I energetically didn't click with. This was just random. And I thought, okay, what is that feeling that I'm feeling? And I had to say to myself, okay, stop. It's irrelevant. You know, that's not for you. You recognize the fact that you feel something here. So just use caution, you know, use caution about how you go about having a conversation with this individual, because it was just a conversation. And I don't normally get that with people. Normally I'm pretty open and, you know.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Okay. So then once you see your life review, is it like I don't want to say a TV, because there's no TVs in heaven, but is it like a screen in the air, or like how, like if you had to put it into earth words, like.
Okay. Well, it is kind of like a TV actually. So I was standing inside of a golden capsule, which is like a room. So if you've ever been in an edit bay, for instance, like if you're editing a TV show and there's like a computer, or it's kind of a darker room, and you sit there and you have to work on a computer. Okay. So it's the darker room, but all of a sudden there's a TV, and every single moment of your life, you are going to watch again. And no, there isn't electricity, like, you know, plug in the cord, right, you know, that type of thing. But it is definite electrical energy of another sort. It is love's energy that keeps things going like that. Now, how they do that TV thing, because it happened to me twice there in my life review and then later with Jesus. And I don't know how they do it.
Interesting. Okay. Okay. So then what happened next after that, the life review?
So after the life review, I went with my guides. They stood outside of the other golden capsule that I went into, and it was Archangel Michael, where he was having a conversation with me. And I was feeling awful, because I'd said horrible things about God, Jesus, heaven, fuck it all. It's basically, I just was like, doesn't exist, blah, blah, blah. No, I'm not buying it. So here was this incredibly, incredibly powerful soul in front of me, who I have described as having this rich, dark chocolate skin hue, or as we would call them, black here on Earth, right? This is a 6'7", incredibly beautiful being who is so powerful and so nurturing and filled with love at the same time. So we had this conversation, and then he said, I remember kneeling before him at one point, but then I was looking in my book recently, and it was my hands were up to the sky. He had me stand and tilt my head back. And he had, he'd been saying the Aramaic version of Psalm 91, and there was this white beam of light coming out. It was love coming out of his hand being directed at my soul. And I had tears. I wasn't sobbing. I just had tears. And I remember feeling like, how am I even worthy of this? How is this even possible? I have never felt loved. So it's like, and to feel this type of love was so extraordinary. I thought, is this a mistake? I mean, there were so many things, and still I was like, well, I have to get home to my son. But then I don't remember if it was before he said the prayer or right after he said the prayer, but the cherubs, there were two cherubs that came in, and they dressed me in what I call a white toga or a robe or whatever. And then there was a stole that went over my right shoulder down to my left hip. And the emblem on the bottom of the stole was of Earth with seven flames coming out of it, indicating I was a visitor from Earth.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. So after he did that, the cherubs got me dressed, he said, come on, there are others who want to meet you. And I'm looking at him like, others? And he said, yeah, God wants to see you. And I'm thinking, God wants to see me? Okay. And then I was realizing, okay, no, come on. There is no God, right? Like, I knew who Jesus was, and Archangel Michael, because I just knew. But anyway, we had to step outside of his capsule, meet my other guides, and we all walked a short ways. And I remember going over this short little bridge, and there was this huge white temple, and there was a big white dome in the center. And there were two decks on both sides of the door, the entrance into the temple. And on each deck was a cherub, golden cherub, blowing the trumpet. They were playing music indicating our arrival. So they were there, and I remember thinking, what is happening? What is going on here? And when Jesus got up to the door, he opened the door, and my other guides went in, and then I followed. And as soon as my foot touched inside the temple, I felt this wave of love that was so warm, so, so incredibly nurturing and powerful. And I just knew, wow, okay, I am somewhere I've never felt this before. I don't know what this place is I'm walking into. There were 77 of us sitting at this table. So I'm thinking, I have no idea who these individuals are. Oh, wait, there's Mahatma Gandhi. Oh, yeah, and there's Paramahansa Yogananda. Oh, okay, I recognize them. Oh, and there's Charan Singh. Okay, so I could recognize some of them. But overall, no, I didn't recognize anybody there. And if I did on a soul level, I wasn't allowed to remember that.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah. So I I walked in and I felt like I was floating to the table. And my other guide sat down and Jesus pulled out my chair and I sat in the chair and he sat to my left. And then there's this old man sitting at the head of the table and he starts talking. And I'm thinking, I'm looking around the table. I'm thinking, who is this old guy? I had no idea who this was. And I'm looking around and everybody's listening to him. I thought, okay, well, this is interesting. And all of a sudden he said, and Megan will be going back to Earth. And boom, he had my attention. And as soon as I heard that, I only thought, oh, fuck. And he stopped talking to the congregation and he looks right at me and he said, oh, fuck is right, Megan. And I went, oh my God, it's God. Because back in catechism, in my, you know, youth, they teach you that God can hear your thoughts. So that's how I knew it was God. And then I fumbled trying to ask for his forgiveness. I called him God. I called him your holiness. I called him, I didn't even remember the other ones. I just remember those two. And I was like, oh, I have so fucked up. And here I am in front of God, right? And so he was like, I'm not offended. And I'm thinking, oh, wow, thank God, right? And he looked at me and he says, it's a man-made word. He said, I'm not offended at all. And he said, but be careful. Be careful what you wish for, because I hear those too. And I thought, that's a big one, you know, because clearly you're hearing me. And if you can hear my wishes too, well, I better make them good from now on. So.
For sure. Yeah. For sure. Yeah. Okay. So what happened next?
Well, at one point, there were so many things that happened at the table, but I'll take you to where, sorry, my allergies are so bad right now. I'll take you to where I had to walk down past the 27 archangels, and then there was Melchizedek at the end on my side of the table, and then Goddess sat straight across from God, and she was absolutely stunning, but everybody at the table was beautiful. Everybody. And I thought, how is this even possible? But I'll get to that. So I looked at Goddess and she smiled and she was very gentle. And she said, it's okay to be yourself. Just be yourself. And I was thinking, what does that mean to be myself? I didn't know. I didn't know how it felt to feel comfortable. I didn't know what that felt like, being comfortable. So then I remember, after I said thank you to her, I learned there that it's blessings received, because everybody said it in unison at one point to me at the table. When I said thank you again, they all said blessings received. And then I was like, oh yeah, blessings received. Okay. Yeah. So after I saw Goddess, then I remember standing next to White Eagle, and he was two seats away from her, to her right. And I stood before him and he looked at me, and I knew who he was because my grandmother had given me, when I was a teenager, this little book called The Quiet Mind by White Eagle. Okay. And it's like little poems or thoughts that he'd written. And he looked at me and said, Megan, when you come across a white feather, I want you to ask yourself, are you doing or are you being? And I stood there thinking, oh gosh, okay, I don't want to mess this up. He's asking me a question. He stops and he says, no, you don't have to answer that question. He said, just think about it. Never forget it. And I've never forgotten it.
That's huge.
Mm-hmm. That's huge. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. And before you continue, who is Goddess? Is it like the female version of God or something else?
Yeah, the female version of God.
Okay. Okay, great. I was hoping that was the answer.
Yeah. And she had wavy, sandy blonde hair to about here, very golden skin hue. I was like, quote unquote, the minority sitting at the table. Everybody was black, brown, or golden skin hue. And here I am, Casper, walking in going, all right. I mean, I don't care. I joke, but it is true. So yes, that's what, and she wore a crown, a platinum crown, and there were 13 chunks of amethyst in her crown in the front. And it was so beautiful. It was just so beautiful. And she was very, very peaceful. And she struck me as being quieter. Whereas God was more, boom, I'm here. Know who I am. And she was more, yeah, I'm here.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Excellent. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so did they deliver any messages for you at the time when you're sitting there with all the ascended masters? Oops, sorry.
Well, they did. So after I saw White Eagle, there were other ones. Okay. So for instance, Charan Singh, he said to me, now Charan Singh was this Indian guru who my mother started following when I was 11. And he did these satsangs, and I'd been to a couple of satsangs, you know, as a teenager. And I'm thinking, okay, what is this Catholic church to this? Totally different. But he had this huge following back in the 80s, maybe back to the 70s, I don't remember. But back in the 80s, he did. And I think he passed in 90 or 91. But he sat there and he looked at me and said, Megan, do you remember that dream that you had that was not a dream when you were a teenager? And I initiated you. You were in India and there were cows walking all around. And I said, yes. And he said, that was really me. I was really initiating you. And I said, oh,
wow.
Okay. And he said, just because your family members didn't follow the teachings of perhaps love as I was teaching, because they kind of fell off the wagon. He said, that doesn't mean that I didn't go to Earth with messages of love for humanity. And, you know, he saying that, it's like, yeah, there are lots of messengers of love that have come.
Absolutely.
And so what he was also saying is, doesn't make me the only one, doesn't make me the exact one to follow, but I am one. So that's huge.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Okay. Any other messages?
Oh, lots. Yeah. So then I went up to, I remember standing next to God. And he looked up at me and he said, Megan, you're driving a car and I'm the passenger in your car. He said, you come to a fork in the road. Which way are you going to go, left or right? And I thought, okay, trick question.
Right.
What is the correct answer? And he said, no. He said, you don't have to answer this. What you need to remember is that either way you go, I'm there with you. I'm always your passenger. And I thought, oh, that's so wonderful. How beautiful. And then I remember respectfully asking him, can I touch your cheek? To which he responded, yes. And I took my right hand and touched the left side of his face and just gently touched his cheek. And then I pulled my hand back and I looked at him and I said, well, now I can tell people that I touched the face of God. And he smiled, and everybody at the table was smiling. And they were all happy to hear that. So yeah, there were many messages there. I don't remember every single one. I do remember when I was talking, it was another time at the table there where I was talking to Kali, and she was this another beautiful female, black. And I just looked at her and she had said something to me. I don't remember what she said. And then I said, may I ask you a question? She said, yes. And I said, respectfully, I said, you're one of the most beautiful beings I've ever seen in my life. How is it that everybody here, and I'm looking around the table, how is it that everybody here is so beautiful? And she said, Megan, if everybody was to look at each other as being love, then you would see the beauty in everybody. And I went, wow, that's true. So that was pretty profound. But then at some point, I don't remember when, I was entered into heaven, and I had experiences inside of heaven after that meeting in temple.
Oh, okay. So the temple wasn't part of heaven then.
It was. Oh, that was just a meeting place.
Okay.
So it was like it had to begin somewhere.
Uh-huh.
But then I remember in temple, there was this huge wooden door. And at one point, and I don't know if I wrote about it in my book or not, but I remember at one point I looked at the door and I said, you mean to tell me if I go through this door, I'm looking at everybody at the table and I was having fun with them too. I said, you mean to tell me if I go through this door, I don't have to go back? And they all smiled in unison and said, yes. And then I thought about it, like, do I go into heaven? Do I go back? Because now I knew I was in heaven. And then I looked back at them and I said, well, now the Catholic guilt's kicking in. I said, nope, I guess I better continue on with my life course on earth, because, you know, that guilt is really difficult to live with. And they all started laughing. So anyway, sometime after that, I was allowed inside where, like, you know, the apartment was, God's house was, like life was happening all around me. So.
Wow. Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So he had a house and everything.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Very modest house. And underneath, so there was this beautiful deck, and I remember being invited into his house, and I've been there a number of times, but this particular time during the near-death experience, I remember going out on the deck, and it was this unbelievably beautiful pink. I want to say it was almost a sunset, but it wasn't a sunset. And the sky was just, oh, these colors were amazing. And the flowers and the trees and the lake and all of this stuff that I saw, it was beautiful.
Wow.
Absolutely beautiful. Like, do you remember the Maxfield Parrish? Do you know who that artist is?
Mm-mm.
Well, he uses just this, he has this very distinct style, but the colors that he uses in the sky and the blues and the pinks.
Uh-huh.
What I saw there in heaven.
Ah, okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
Yeah.
So they actually took you around the place, right? If you're seeing the houses, if you're seeing his house and that, you're being kind of walked around, or? Okay.
Yeah. I was being guided and I was staying in this tent, this purple tent. And I don't know why I had to stay in the tent, but anyway, I did. And I remember at one point I was taken to my violin class. So everybody has to go back and playing violin. So when you get into heaven, your soul knows. I mean, you already know how to play violin, but it's to help you continue to balance the male, female, and your brain and your just your entire being, your meridians, your chakras, everything. So okay. you stay completely aligned. And I remember God and Goddess were sitting in these golden chairs, and I don't know how many of us were there playing because we all had to show up for class. Mm-hmm. And there's Mozart handing out sheet music that he'd written, you know, for what we were going to be playing. So we all played, and that was the end of our class. And all of a sudden I remember hearing flapping above me, flapping. And I thought, what? And I looked up. There were so many archangels that were flying above me. And I remember then all of a sudden, the three rows of bleachers that appeared like next to God and Goddess, right? In front of everybody. And I was up toward the front, if not in the front. And the archangels landed and they started singing. And they started singing in an octave I'd never heard before. I've never heard it on this planet before. Yeah, it was so incredible and it was so angelic, but it was also, it was, there's something to do with, so what I also remember, so putting the archangels aside for a second, it reminds me of the, I forget who gave me the information, but the two notes, the B sharp and C flat or C sharp B flat. I can't remember. I wrote it down in my book. When these three octaves on a piano or an organ are played simultaneously, it opens up heaven's gateway. Like literally you can get into heaven and you can just channel love. I mean, you can feel the love. So if you meditate, if you pray, if you don't do anything but sit still and you just want to close your eyes and just listen to those notes, start listening for what it is that the messages are that you're needing to receive. I encourage people to do that. You can even ask that your whole body vibrate in those notes.
Wow.
You know, okay. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I can ask heaven for anything.
Of course. Absolutely. Yeah. You're the creator in a human body.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So what were the notes again?
I have to look up if it was B sharp, C flat. I think it was C sharp, B flat.
Okay.
But it's the C and the B. And so across the board of the piano. And I remember that. And that opens up. That opens up the gateway onto the highway of just heaven's love.
Wow. It's,
yeah.
Okay. Interesting.
Yeah. Interesting.
So then, okay. So then once you are in this space of heaven, what happens next?
Okay. At one point I remember walking down the sidewalk and I'm looking down on the ground and I could see somebody was coming in front of me. And so I looked up and it was Freddie Mercury. And I thought, oh my God, this is heaven, because I'm a Queen fan since they came to the US and I loved Freddie Mercury. So here I am going, whoa, this is so cool. So I looked at him and I said, oh my God, you're Freddie Mercury. And he goes, yeah, yeah. How are you doing? You know? So we had this short conversation and I told him how I was feeling on earth. And he said, okay, do you want to go and have some fun? And I said, yes. And so he took my hand, he turned around and we started walking in the direction that I was going. And he takes me to this outdoor amphitheater. And so somehow he disappears. I don't remember how he got away from me, because I would have hung with Freddie Mercury for sure, but that comes later. So there are all these souls that are there and we're all wearing the white robes, right? And I remember the opening act, because it turned out to be a show. So the opening act was Spike Jones and Billy Barty. And then the next act was Ella Fitzgerald and Cole Porter. And then the next act was the Queen Band, which was comprised of Terry Kath, Marvin Gaye, Rick James, Buddy Rich, and of course, Freddie Mercury.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just so incredible. I mean, so incredible. And I remember dancing. And I remember dancing, there was a soul next to me who, she had her hair up in a bun and she had on the white toga as well. And we were laughing because we just had so much fun dancing. I mean, it was, I was just elated.
With bliss.
Yeah, absolutely.
Beautiful. What happened next?
So after that show, I remember having to go back to my tent. And I don't remember who brought me back there. I don't remember if, you know, Archangel Michael or Jesus came back and got me. I don't remember how that happened, but we all wound up going into my tent. And I remember Freddie Mercury was sitting across from me and Terry Kath was to right, my version of right. And then I think it was Marvin Gaye and then Rick James and then Billy Barty was there. And the 27 archangels that were at God's table and temple were there at this table in my tent. So this is a pretty big tent. And they did not drink. I will just vouch for heaven. The archangels did not drink. They do not drink and fly. But anyway, the rest of us, however, were drinking red wine. And there were bread. There was bread inside these baskets that were on the table laid out for each of us to eat as we like. And the cherubs would come in and fill our glasses or the decanter because we were drinking so much. And what we were conversing about, I remember conversing with Freddie Mercury, each one of them actually going, okay, well, who were you in my last life? And who was I to your last life? And, you know, how did we link up in this life? So we discovered all of this stuff together. And then I remember at one point, these cherubs started flying into my tent and they started lighting up the inside of the tent, and in walks Prophet Muhammad, and we all stood and bowed. And then there were cherubs on the outside of the tent. There were like 300 cherubs. Wow. I mean, there were hundreds. And so he indicated with his hands to sit down. And he looked directly at me, did not waste any time. And he said, you will go back to Earth and you will tell everybody that I have never left the Middle East. I continue to pray for them, but I'm praying for the entire world. I love everybody. I mean, it was very clear that the message of love was for everyone. Didn't matter what you believe, doesn't matter. So when he was done talking, I remember he gave me a moment and I felt in that moment that it was okay to ask him a question. So I said, may I ask you a question? And he said, yes. And I said, respectfully, I don't know what you want with me. Like, I'm ex-Catholic, ex-atheist. I have no idea what I am right now. So could you, like, I said, why do you want me to go back to Earth and say this? Why do you want me to tell people about you? I know nothing about you. I mean, we just met here in temple and I don't know anything about Islam. And he said, it doesn't matter. He said, I have my ways. And I thought, well, okay. I mean, there's such a power about him.
Yeah.
So Jesus, they're both, by the way, Archangel Mike, excuse me, Jesus and Prophet Muhammad are the exact frequency of love. They're the exact frequency of love. And they are the two that mesh with God's face on the negative of this galaxy of life. And so that's in our reality in this galaxy. It's those three and that are like the primary. It started off with Judaism, okay? Yeah. And it goes into Catholicism, or it branches off into all these different things. But the power in knowing that, if I could just, you know, people have this such a strong feeling, not everybody, okay, I can't speak for everybody, but I have met some who have such a strong feeling like, oh no, it has to be this way, or oh no, it has to be this way.
Yeah.
And in fact, each way is merged. It's humanity who has distorted what reality
yep.
is.
Yep.
So what we can do coming back from these near-death experiences or what our personal beliefs of love are, is mm-hmm. to continue to spread love's messages of, oh, this was a biggie. So God, I forgot, back in temple, and everybody and everybody that I was affiliated with in heaven, every archangel, every ascended master, God, Goddess, they all said to me at various times, acceptance is synonymous with love. So if we could just go around with that message and give that to each of us, yeah. and spread that word of love around. And that means, that doesn't just mean for humanity. Mm-hmm. That would be great though. Let's start there. We have to start somewhere.
Yeah.
Okay, we do. But accept one another for our differences, because guess what? The differences are only what you perceive as being different. We're all the same.
Yep.
We're all the same. I don't care what the skin hue is. Makes no difference, because every single one of us is this white flame of love in our souls. And so that's how we all begin, with that.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. How beautiful. Mm-hmm. How beautiful. So then how did you come back into your body? How did they take you from heaven back into earth?
Well, just to finish off with Prophet Muhammad, because there's so much more that happens.
Oh, yeah, but, yeah. Go ahead.
But just to let you know, he, when he said, I have my ways, I said, okay. And I just knew that I had to do this somehow. I knew that I had to speak that truth somehow.
Okay.
So after he left, all of us sat quiet at the table. It was like, it was a sobering moment, you know, because here we are living it up, having a good time, laughing, cracking jokes. And then all of a sudden we're thinking about reality. So I believe it was Marvin Gaye who broke the silence. And he said, Megan, you don't know what it was like to be a Black man in the civil rights movement. You don't know what it was like to be spat on. You don't know what it was like to be beaten for no reason. He said, what we want you to do is to go back and share all of these stories. Have our voices heard, because we would have to reincarnate and then try and figure out where we are coming through our lives to hopefully get back to where we are right now mentally. He says, but we don't have to do that. We can just give you the information. You go back and you share it with people. And I thought, okay. So he shared his story, you know, Rick James, Ella Fitzgerald, they all talked about the civil rights movement. And then, and to what detail, I don't remember, but I do know that that was their like common thread in conversation with me. Mm-hmm. The other person who got up was Billy Barty. And he said, look, he said, I want you to tell everybody what it was like to be a little person and be a child in the 1920s. He said, I'd be walking down the street with my parents and people would stop and laugh and say, oh, look at the funny little boy, or look at the funny little man. He needs to be in the circus. So he said that was very difficult. I had tears just streaming down my face, because I'd met Billy Barty a couple of times in my life here on earth, once as a child and once as an adult.
Interesting.
And then I see him in heaven. So I thought, wow, okay. And I'd like to plug in here that Billy Barty came back, you know, Billy Barty, he didn't come back in this life, but I mean, in terms of how he felt as a child, he broke into himself. And at one point he started the Little People's Association of America. And that was in the 1960s, I believe. I mean, who did that? He couldn't get a job. He was so upset that people, you know, the little people weren't getting fair pay and they weren't getting fair jobs, which is true.
Yeah.
So that was Billy Barty. The others, they all shared their stories. And then I remember there were other conversations that I had in heaven, but getting to your answer your question of like how I got back to my body, I remember I was standing under, or actually I was standing near the tree, but Saint Germain was under the tree holding his knees and he was sitting on the ground. And Jesus and I were standing next to the tree in the sun. And he and I were conversing and he said, "Well, it's time for you to go back." And I said, "But Jesus, I don't want to go back." I said, "Please, please don't make me go back." And he looked at me and he said, "Megan, I don't make the rules. I follow them just like you do." And I was like, "Oh, that's right. You're not God. Okay. All right." So then he made this like 11 by 14 or 8 by 10 frame appear with my then husband and my son, our son's face. They were both there and they were looking at me and they never moved their mouths. Everything was telepathic. There was a lot of telepathy. And then there was, you know, talking out loud like we're doing right now. But I remember them both looking at me saying, "Don't go, we need you." To which I responded, looking at Jesus saying, "Oh my God, my son needs me." That was the whole reason that I wanted to get out of wherever I was when I first got there, you know?
Yeah.
So Jesus simply said, "Okay, well, I guess you have to go." And then I remember I had to go take, I turned around and I started walking down the road and I had to take my stole and my toga back to this little shack where there was a wicker basket inside and put it in there. And then I exited out and I started walking back toward the clouds and all of these angels, these cherubs, started flying out of this forest area or trees where there were trees, but there was this tall grass and there was Prophet Muhammad. And I thought, whoa. So he met me in the center. So like we met and I looked at him and I said, "I don't want to go back." And he said, "I know." And he said, "But you have to." And he said, "But remember, my hand is always at your back." He says, "I will never leave your side. I will never leave you." And then I respectfully, I said to him, "Look, forgive me. I grew up Catholic. I don't know if this is okay, but can I give you a hug?" And he said, "Yes." And so I reached up around his neck and I gave him a hug and he put his arms around my back. And then as soon as I let go, he let go. And I stood there in front of him and I said, "I love you." And he said, "I love you too." So that was how I left heaven. And I had to walk back through the clouds. And I remember waking up in the hospital room and I looked at the nurse because I think it had to be a nurse. She was there not knowing what I was going to do because I'd been out of it for so long. And I said, "I just saw Jesus," because I didn't remember Prophet Muhammad right off the top, because I'd remembered Jesus. So.
Wow. Okay. So how long were you under while this was happening?
So heaven, it's 5 days in heaven, but figure 15 days on earth. So it was like 2 weeks on earth that I was out of it. And I remember coming to at certain moments, like one moment I woke up, my eyes just opened and they were doing dialysis or plasmapheresis on me because dialysis with this autoimmune disease has to be followed by plasmapheresis in order for any hope of the individual to survive. So I had a very extreme case of the TTPHUS. It's of course not the worst case because there was a woman who had a worse case than me. She only had 4 platelets left. I had about 30,000 left. Wow. You know, and normal is anywhere from 140,000, 145,000 up to like 475,000, something like that, 450,000. Anyway, so I, where was I? I'm trying to remember what I was just going to tell you. I got sidetracked on the health thing.
So I was asking about, you said you saw Muhammad, you said goodbye, and I don't remember where you were going with that either.
Oh, I know. So there was another point while I was in that 2 week period of time that I was out of it, where I opened my eyes and I was being given the procedure. I was on machines and I grabbed this nurse's wrist, and it took her by surprise because I remember she was looking up at the monitor and she looked down at me and I said, "You have to get me off this floor or I'm going to die here." And she, her immediate response was, "Well, that's too much paperwork for me." And I looked at her and that's what I thought. Oh my God, she's going to do what the other doctor did. And she looked at me, she says, "Well, my husband's the head of the sixth floor, the sickest unit in this hospital. I'll have you moved." And she did. And I thought, oh my gosh, wow. So heaven would give me instructions of what to say. That's who told me to make a scene, make it big, or you won't make it out. That's who told me to fire the doctor. Well, they didn't tell me to fire him, but they just told me to make a scene, make it bigger, make it out. But they also told me to wake up and alert her that I needed to be moved or I was going to die there.
Wow.
And I would have died on that floor because the nurses were so young, right out of college. They didn't know what to do with me. I mean, it was not good. Wow. So I had to get some real, like, skilled individuals. So I did. Got it.
Okay. So they moved you, and so you were in the hospital for how long?
Total? 2 months.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had to learn how to walk again. I had to learn. My vision was going, and it was just awful. Everything. I had to talk. I couldn't sit up. You know, there was one point where I remember the nurses coming in, they would make me stand up to take my weight and then have me lay back down again. And then it got to a point where I couldn't even stand up. And I remember them rolling me over. This is when I'd gained all that fluid. They would roll me over and then put this tarp underneath me and hook it up to this machine, basically. And then wind me up to get my weight. So I'm off the bed. And I remember my head looking up at the ceiling. I couldn't move my head. It was like I was hanging. Wow. It was so weird. Yeah. It was very strange.
Wow. Okay. And so tell me then, how has your life changed since this occurrence, this event?
Well, I definitely believe in Jesus now, and I definitely believe in love, and I definitely know love exists. I know that it is the most powerful energy that exists throughout everything. Love controls everything. It's not a religion. Heaven is not a religious place, by the way. I also know this. It's not a religious thing. So I grew up Catholic, so I'll speak for myself and what I can say about having grown up Catholic. That was in such a religious context that there was a heaven, as though it couldn't be had for somebody outside of that religion. And that's not the case at all. It's not the case at all, because I went in as an atheist. So it's a place that is filled with acceptance. And as I sat there with Lakshmi and Vishnu and Prophet Muhammad and Jesus and Sitting Bull and White Eagle and all of these archangels and Kali and, you know, whoever else, no one was going, "Oh, I'm holding the stake here. This is my territory." The only one who could do that was God. That's it. That's it. So everybody was working in unison, everyone, and everyone was there to teach love. So it was very, very beautiful. So I haven't forgotten that. I chose to divorce years later because my then husband just didn't want to hear about it anymore, ever again. But he wasn't there for me, you know? Wow. I mean, he was there for me in and out. Like, he wasn't there at the hospital with me the entire time.
Wow.
Oh, no. There were other things. His work was going on, and that was his priority. So, you know, there were just things that I realized, wow, okay, I'm not understood at home. This is really difficult to understand anyway, coming back from a near-death experience.
Yeah.
And how to apply yourself in life again, because you don't necessarily fit into a mold that exists. Although we exist. And it's like, if there was going to be a church of anything, well, let's make it the church of love. Okay, what was your message of love? What was your message of love? And combine it all, because it's all, that's our common thread, is the love, you know? Mm-hmm. So yeah, it changed my life significantly.
Wow, that's beautiful. So did you have like a regular job back in before, like a regular, like 9 to 5?
A long time ago. Yeah. I mean, I was a stay-at-home mom at that time.
Oh, okay. Perfect. Perfect. Okay. So then what, did you continue to be a stay-at-home mom for a while? I mean, I guess how fast was the divorce after this happened?
I didn't file for divorce for another 6.5 years.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah. 6.5 years later, because I really thought he would eventually come around.
Yes.
And want to say, oh, wow, or share with me, you know, that really affected me in such a way I couldn't handle it. And I didn't know how to articulate my feelings or my fear or anything. There was nothing. Not once did he ever say to me, I'm so glad you're here. And I remember telling him that. I remember confronting him about that. And I said, you've never once said that you're happy I'm here. And he didn't. And until that moment, he said, well, I'm happy you're here. But it was in a defensive mechanism. And I thought, no, you know what? You're really not.
Yeah.
And that's okay. It is what it is.
Right. Right.
So now I understand. All right. You served your purpose as I've served my purpose in your life.
Yep.
And we're just going to have to be good with that.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. So tell us about the messages that you receive now, that you're able to receive that you didn't receive before from God.
So I started hearing, I started getting messages after this had happened. This was 16 years ago. So I started getting messages back then, and I'd get a message for my friend or a couple of my friends. And they're like, how did you know that? And I'd say, I'm just hearing this information. I don't know what to do with this. So then it kept happening. And then I remember I thought, well, let me try tarot cards. That's not an easy thing to do. And I went, this is not my thing. I'm not feeling this. So then I tried an oracle deck with the angels, the archangels, as a matter of fact, because I thought, well, I've met them all. So let's see what the angels have to say. Nope, not dealing. It's not my thing. Not my thing. And one day in meditation, because every day I talk to heaven, every single day. And one day in meditation, they said, just listen. Just listen. So I thought, okay. And so I just started listening. And then boom, boom, boom. And then I started getting the visuals. And then I could get the feeling. And then I could get like an emotion, or I even got the scent a few times. That's a tough one. When you can smell something, I started to get that as well. So yeah, or I could hold something and feel it and get a feeling from that.
Yes.
So I can do that as well. But not everybody is the same. Like when I channel for individuals, they're not the same. Some people, they say, because I'm also a medium. So people on earth know a medium is being able to talk to the dead. Well, technically talking to heaven is like, quote unquote, talking to the dead, right? So, but I do actually talk to loved ones. Okay. And no joke. I really do. And there was a woman, for instance, today who I connected with, and she said, oh, you know, at the end of our session, she said, you know, I was really hoping that you would have been able to talk to my grandmother. And I said, well, you know, heaven's putting through all this other information. I said, what's your grandmother's name? And let's go, let's see. And so I definitely connected with her. And it was very comforting because everything was just, oh, yeah, yeah, you know. So it's great to be able to do that with people and for them, you know, or to be able to sometimes answer questions, very difficult situations sometimes. And it's not easy. One time, I also get messages through dreams. One time, I remember my son, when he was a teenager, his friend's cousin had disappeared. And so the mother, or the aunt actually, had called me and said, I need to know if she's still alive. I need to know if she's still alive. And I thought, oh, because I've always asked Kevin, don't tell me about death. I don't want anybody's end. I just don't want to know. Yeah. And so I remember the next morning, I woke up and I saw the girl, and she had passed, and she was only 16, and she had drowned, and she was washed away in a rainstorm. So it was just tragic in her car. So, you know, I didn't want to call this woman and tell her.
Yeah.
Because then I thought, what if I'm wrong? But I wasn't. Because later on that day, at the end of the day, I found out that that's how she was found. So, you know, sometimes it's like, oh, I don't. But if I don't say it now, I know, like, if I don't give the message, it's not fair. I don't know how to describe that, but that's how I feel.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, if you're receiving it, probably it's because you need to give it.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah. I would say.
Definitely. Yeah. So now that's what you do. You are a medium and you give messages to people. You do sessions, right?
Yeah, I do.
Wow.
Yeah, and I've written two books, one about my near-death experience called A Catalyst, My 5 Days in Heaven. And then after I filed for divorce, it was such a tedious, long, involved process that it was so depressing. And in meditation one day, all of my guides, everybody in heaven, they said, write about love every day. That's your mission. So I did. And whatever it was that I was feeling in that day, it had to be around the context of love, had to be a love's message. So that's what the next book is. It's called Love's Recipes. And literally you could open it up and it's a one page message of love. There's nothing. I mean, I think the longest message was like 8 pages or something.
Okay. You
know, a little story inside of a bigger story, but it's all love.
Yeah.
It's all love based. So I do that. And I did a podcast called Conversations with Megan. And I'm putting together a course right now about how to heal yourself and align incongruency with love. So I'm putting together a course about messages that I learned in heaven, because there's so much more that I learned. And like Jesus and I had this incredible conversation about love.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm bringing that into the course, you know, to really break it down for individuals, because it doesn't matter what you were raised to believe or not to believe.
Right.
You still want to heal with love and know that love exists.
Yeah.
And if you don't, you should, but you know, choice is the whole thing. So I get that.
Yeah, absolutely. That's so beautiful. That's wonderful. Where can people find you?
Well, they can find me. They can email me at conversationswithmegan1@gmail.com.
Great. And do you have a website?
Yes, it's 5daysinheaven.com. And that is the number 5 spelled out.
Okay. And then if somebody wants to book a session with you, where would they go?
Just email me at conversationswithmegan1.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I will get it. It's at Gmail. So yeah, just email me, or you'll see it on 5 days www.mariaandheaven.com. My email address is on there as well.
Oh, okay. All right. Excellent. Do you have any idea when this course is going to be out?
Yes, actually, I'm working on it right now, and it should be done by toward the end of April. End of April, May. And in May, I'm doing a 2-day event in Sedona, Arizona, where I'm inviting people to come and hear my story, my friend's story, about our near-death experiences, because she channels angelic codes through song. She's an angelic songstress as a result of hers. And so she's going to share her skills. I will share mine.
All right. Well, thank you, Megan. Thank you for again for your time. And I'm sure we'll talk to you again. Thanks, everybody, for watching. See you soon.